Good morning and welcome everyone to the 29th meeting of government. And can I ask you to please ensure all your mobile phones are in silent? And just a reminder that broadcasting will operate your camera and microphone as usual. Please allow a short pause before being called on to speak to allow them to do so. Today's public business item one is a consideration of a statutory instrument followed by opening evidence on a member's bill. But first, item one, we have consideration of whether to take agenda items 6 and 7 in private. Item 6 is consideration of the evidence received on that bill, the European Charter of Local Self-Government and Corporation Scotland Bill. Item 7 is consideration of an approach to scrutiny of a common framework on hazardous substances planning. As we're meeting remotely, rather than asking whether everyone agrees, I will instead ask if anyone objects. If there is silence, I will assume you are content. Does anyone object? In that case, I will take that as agreed, and items 6 and 7 will be taken in private. Agenda item 2, the committee will take evidence on the draft valuation, postponement of revaluation, Coronavirus Scotland Order 2020, and I welcome Ben McPherson, Minister for Public Finance and Migration, Ian Storey, Head of Non-Domestic Rates Policy, and Anouk Berthier, Non-Domestic Rates Team Leader, Scottish Government. This instrument is laid under the affirmative procedure, which means that Parliament must approve it before the provisions can come into force. Following this evidence session, the committee will be invited at the next agenda item to consider the motion to approve the instrument. We also sought views on the instrument from interested bodies, and responses received are set out at an Annex B of Paper 1. And I remind everyone that Scottish Government officials can speak under this item, but not in the debate that follows. I now invite the Minister to make a short opening statement.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, colleagues. First of all, thank you to the committee for the opportunity to give evidence today and to make this statement. I hope that our written evidence provided helpful context, and I was grateful for the opportunity to discuss the Scottish Government's position with several members of the committee in recent weeks. I would like to start by highlighting once again that what we are considering is not a party political issue. It is a judgment about balancing risk for the benefit of businesses and the public finances. Indeed, for context, the delay to the revaluation date that the Scottish Government is proposing, 2023, has been called for by the Conservative Government in Westminster and the Labour Government in Wales. What's more, as a reminder, a delay was also requested by Ruth Davidson in the Chamber on the 1st of September, the day our proposal to do exactly that was announced in the Programme for Government. The decision before the committee today is ultimately a simple binary choice. If the committee supports the instrument in question, then the next revaluation will take place in 2023 with a one-year tone date of the 1st of April 2022. On the other hand, if the committee rejects this instrument, then the next revaluation is scheduled in law to take place in 2023, generally a two-year tone date of the 1st of April 2020. Despite this binary choice, I anticipate that the committee may wish to explore the government's view on a third option of a 2022 revaluation with a 2021 tone date. However, I must emphasise from the outset that the government has absolutely no intention to consider this option if today's instrument is rejected. The option of a 2022 revaluation with a 2021 tone date was, of course, one that we in government carefully considered, but ultimately rejected. And our decision was based upon risk. Those arguing for a 2021 tone date appear to be doing so based primarily upon following the word of the Barclay Review, whilst respectfully overlooking the spirit of the review. I submit that their arguments do not adequately take into account the impact of the situation we are now faced with as a result of the pandemic. And for the committee's awareness, I have not actually seen evidence to justify a 2021 tone date. Furthermore, from an operational delivery perspective, I must also point out that a 2021 tone date would require assessors with only around 15 months' notice to essentially deliver a six-month revaluation in order to inform the Scottish budget process. So while some may use the word challenging to describe a potential 2022 revaluation with a 2021 tone date, I would argue that such a proposal runs the risk of compromising the entire revaluation exercise. Firstly, there are the operational impacts of the pandemic. It is little over 4 months until the 1st of April 2021, and unfortunately the number of COVID cases continues to increase. We know that the rating profession have appropriately taken up the Chancellor's furlough scheme, and for much of the summer the profession was subject to national lockdown. We also know that the private sector rating agents are typically city-based, but often provide a national service. Conversely, assessors have local offices, but often cover multiple local authorities. We need to consider that in the light of the fact that under the strategic framework, one third of local authorities are now entering level four and subject to travel restrictions. And it is not conceivable that some areas may be significantly restricted again between now and April. Moreover, where businesses are open, we know that some have refused to allow strangers, including rating surveyors and assessors, on site to reduce the risk of COVID transmission. Considering all of this disruption, put simply, there are temporarily fewer professionals to do the job of reevaluation, and where they are available, there are legal and structural impediments preventing them from doing their jobs. Secondly, we also need to consider the risk of a lack of evidence on which to base a potential 2022 revaluation with a 2021 tone date. There have been approximately 50,000 appeals lodged since COVID claiming a material change of circumstance. Some of those are believed to be duplicates, but every valid appeal is entitled to request an expedited hearing. However, despite the financial and economic challenges facing businesses, there has not been a single request for an expedited hearing to my knowledge. And I think that is clear and compelling. That is a clear and compelling indication that appellants do not yet hold the evidence to support their case. Furthermore, on Thursday, the Federation of Small Businesses published a poll that found that 7 out of 10 Scottish rent paying businesses have been forced to pay rent as normal through this crisis. Colleagues, we may disagree on various things, but I'm sure we agree that 2020 has been far from normal, as FSB have evidenced for almost 70% of small businesses. More fundamentally, I am not aware of any credible evidence having been provided to assessors to support a change in rateable value. These points are undoubtedly correlated, and they point to a lack of robust evidence upon which to base a revaluation without significant risk of unintended but utterly predictable consequences. Revaluations are revenue neutral by design, and in order to maintain the income stream which supports public services we all rely on through local government, they therefore inevitably create a situation where those that see their rate liabilities increase are offset by those that see their liabilities fall. The winners and losers, and I use those phrases advisedly, are not a matter of political influence, but are determined on the basis of regional and sectoral rental evidence. I'm not suggesting that this evidence cannot come forward in time for the 1st of April 2021, but on the basis of the verifiable evidence available to ministers, we have no confidence that it will. And certainly not in a way that fully reflects the impact of COVID-19 or Brexit, nor in the volumes or sectoral and geographic coverage necessary to enable a stable re-evaluation. Colleagues, I believe it is important that we give the market time to stabilise, to allow the evidence to catch up with reality and identify the correct winners and losers, rather than risk using structurally deficient evidence. And indeed, when it comes to considering the winners and losers of an upcoming re-evaluation, it is undeniably clear from the written evidence provided ahead of today's meeting that the overwhelming priority for the Scottish business community is certainty over the future of reliefs. That is where our focus should be after today's decision has been taken. However, I must also reiterate, as the Cabinet Secretary has previously emphasised, that given the constraints of the fiscal framework, decisions over the future of COVID-19 reliefs can only be taken in the context of UK government spending decisions. And we therefore hope that the Chancellor will provide that certainty in his statement next week to allow us to reflect those decisions in the Scottish budget, rather than awaiting his March budget, which is only weeks before the current relief is scheduled to expire. In closing, convener, there is no political nor even financial benefit to the Scottish Government from delaying revaluation. However, there are significant unintended consequences if we do not, and if values at revaluation are not accurate and robust. Whilst nothing in 2020 has been ideal, delaying the revaluation is a prudent and pragmatic, practical measure we can collectively take to respond appropriately to the consequences of the global pandemic. Delaying the revaluation is the majority view of business organisations in Scotland, and I hope that the committee will appreciate the risk-based approach we have taken to the next revaluation. If this instrument before the committee does not proceed, then as I emphasised earlier, there will not be a delay to the revaluation or a change of tone date. Therefore, I hope that members will support our proposal today, which seeks to ensure fairness for Scottish ratepayers in aggregate, whilst maintaining the stability of public finances. And I look forward to any questions the committee may have. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Minister, for that full explanation of your view. We have three members that wish to ask questions. If any others have got a question they'd like to ask, will you please put R in the request box? And I'll start off with Sarah, to be followed by Alexander and then Andy White. Sarah?
Thank you, Convener, and thank you for the Minister for the opportunity to meet in advance. Minister, you said that the majority of Scottish businesses supported the delay of the tone date, but the evidence we've got is that they don't support the tone date that you have actually proposed to us today. So I'd like you to address that specific issue. You've also suggested that if this tone date proposal wasn't passed, that you would not bring forward the alternative tone date, which many businesses have got in touch to say that they would prefer. And can you explain the economic assessment that you have carried out to date? Because you said in your brief introductory remarks that you have looked at the economy, you've assessed the risks, but can you specifically address the difference between a tone date of 2021 and 2022, which is the key concern that we have had from businesses? The release issue, I accept, but that is something we come back to. Thank you.
Minister?
Thank you, Convener. Thank you, Sarah Boyack. Three important questions there. First of all, with regard to the considerations of the business community, we have not just read the submissions with interest, but also had significant engagement with the business community before the announcement in the Programme for Government, certainly appropriate engagement, and have met with a variety of business organisations and discussed this point on several occasions since the COVID pandemic began, as you would expect. And I don't think it's fair to say that the business community has a preferred position. There are differentiated positions. So, for example, the Federation of Small Businesses have stated in their submission to the committee that they broadly support the Scottish Government's decision to change their approach to the revaluation cycle, as they've done in England and Wales. Also, the CBI in Scotland said the CBI understands the practical arguments in favour of postponing the non-domestic rates revaluation in light of the impact of the pandemic to 23-24 and because of the associated restrictions that have had on individuals, businesses and the Scottish economy as a whole. So we appreciate that there are some business organisations that do not agree with the proposition we've put forward, but there is not a unified position on the change of the tone date and the revaluation. However, where there is a unified position in the submissions that I've seen to the committee, is that the revaluation date should change from the current position of a tone date of the 1st of April 2020 and a revaluation in 2022. The proposal that is brought forward today in that there's a preferred position to change from the current status quo is absolutely the shared view. For example, I note that the Scottish Property Federation in their submission have said that while their preference would be for the alternative position of tone date in 2021 with a revaluation in 2022, they are certainly very clear in their submission also that they do not want to see the status quo continue. So the main point is that there are different positions. The next point you asked was around the evidence for a 2021 What assessment what considerations we've undertaken that the evidence base for 2021 won't be accurate. And I would refer back to my opening statement and the points I made about a balance of risk. There is no easy answer to the question of the correct tone date. And our approach was risk-based in that regard. We take the view that the structural deficit between the economic reality and the market rental evidence will persist into 2021-22 because the number of COVID-19 cases are still rising and there is continued uncertainty around Brexit. Therefore, temporarily, as I mentioned in my opening statement, fewer professionals are there to do the job of revaluation. And where they are available, there are legal and structural impediments preventing them from doing their jobs. For example, as I said, private sector agents were furloughed and may still be. Private sector agents are predominantly city-based, but operate nationally, and assessors are regional by straddle of local authority boundaries. So essential movement restrictions were in place for much of the summer and appear likely to return in some areas. And as I said as well in my opening statement, businesses are blocking access to premises for non-workers, including rating surveyors and assessors. And record keeping is often still paper-based and therefore more challenging to access whilst home working. And in the coming months, we are advised that access to assessment offices will be prioritised for electoral staff rather than valuation staff. So the practical considerations for gathering the evidence ahead of next year are constrained from an operational perspective. But also, that has, of course, there are further considerations around whether the market will have adjusted. And again, I would point to my opening statement and the point I emphasised around the survey that the FSB have put forward, where 70% of those surveyed by the small business community have said that there hasn't been a renegotiation between tenants and landlords of commercial property. And therefore, in the arrangements, the lease arrangements between tenants and landlords, the reality of the current situation and the challenges faced by businesses hasn't caught up with the situation that is presented, with the situation that would be able to be evidenced ahead of next year. So all of these considerations, practical, evidence-based, have been balanced by ourselves to give the best possible chance for the evidence base to have caught up. And we think by setting a tone date of 2022, it gives the best chance for that evidence to have caught up in order to make sure that there's a robust position in which to base the next 3-year revaluation. I don't know if Ian and Anouk, would you be able to come in here with any further points to substantiate?
Is there a request? Anouk, do you want to come in? Okay. Oh, sorry, Anouk, yes.
Yes, hello. I'm sorry, I would simply like to say that on the final question which Ms. Boyack asked on the impact assessment, this would require an accurate assessment of essentially something that's in the future of different rents on different dates. So 2020, 21, or even 22, if we're thinking ahead, would translate into revaluation rateable values. This would also require an accurate estimate of the poundage in subsequent years, and it would have to take into account any public support that might be offered, for example, through relief. And so businesses would need, and government would need, to have access to an assessment of all these parameters in order to form a full judgment. As Mr. McPherson has said, our concern is that this rental evidence will not be available in 2021, and that it will not be robust in terms of reflecting revaluation. I think we have to remember that the Barclay Review's key recommendation about moving to regular revaluations with a one-year tone was that revaluation values, rateable values, reflect economic circumstances as at the time of revaluation. And I think we're very much trying to deliver this spirit by introducing a one-year tone with a revaluation that actually has stable, robust, reliable post-COVID values.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, Alexander, and Minister, can I ask if you could try and keep your answers a bit short? Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Convener. And can I thank the Minister for early discussions as well with him on this matter. Can I ask the Minister, normally the Scottish Government are very robust in their consultation and engagement. Organisations have made that clear that on this occasion, that didn't seem to be the case, Minister, that the Chamber of Commerce or Licensed Trade Association or the Property Federation, etc., they did not feel that they were consulted in the normal manner that the Scottish Government normally do. And my second question is, with reference to regional situations across Scotland, can I ask the Minister to comment on the sort of North East situation, where they find themselves, particularly in the current situation where the downturn has happened in their economic gas and oil industry, they find themselves potentially penalised under this process, and that has an impact on regional parts of Scotland when you are looking at this revaluation and tone date. So if I could have answers to both of these, Convener, thank you.
Thank you very much. Minister?
Thank you. Important questions again. First of all, we have a duty, as you would expect, with a proposition like this to inform Parliament first. So that is why it was in the programme for government. The formal position that the Scottish Government put forward was in the programme for government. But of course, in the last year, we've all had to react in a more rapid way than we would normally do. But we did engage in business on this issue in May, a conference call with UK Hospitality and also with the Federation of Small Businesses. In June, I took part in the regular weekly call that the Scottish Government has with all the business organisations and asked for their thoughts on both revaluation and a tone date. In July, I had a meeting with the Scottish Retail Consortium. In August, with a number of property commercial property providers, and in August again with the valuation appeal panels, in August again with the Scottish Property Federation, and then since the announcement in the programme for government, there's been a lot of engagement with business organisations that for the sake of being succinct, Convener, I won't list through. However, I hope that illustrates to the committee and to Mr. Stewart that there was significant appropriate engagement with business, but because of the time frame and the need to inform Parliament of our position first, and which is why it was in the programme for government, there was not a consultation exercise to the extent that there may be in other times. But it is not correct for those who have asserted to say that there wasn't engagement with business organisations. There absolutely was, and it was done proactively. On the other important points that have been raised around considerations with regard to different geographies and sectors, and concerns that some stakeholders have about a detachment between business rates and rental values as things stand. The Scottish Government recognises these points, and that's why consideration around reliefs, particularly in the coming period, although subject to Barnett consequentials, are where our focus is, and I think our collective focus should be. But I don't think those arguing for a 2021 year tone, which, as I've stated, runs the real risk that evidence that assessors are legally obliged to follow simply doesn't reflect the reality. If those risks manifest, then they would then exist for the full period of the next revaluation. So the whole ethos of our argument for a tone date of 2022 and a revaluation in 23 is that we don't want the next period, the next 3 years after that, to not reflect the reality in the way that those in the Northeast argue that the current position doesn't reflect the reality of the situation for businesses there, and that there's a detachment between business rates and rental values. So it cannot be a solution to deal with a detachment between business rates and rental values in the here and now in some sectors in some places by taking a position that could create that risk for the whole country. And that is why it's the prudent thing to do to have a revaluation in 2023 with a 2022 tone date to give both the market and the evidence base the best chance to catch up and then be reflective of the reality in the 3-year period following that. So I hope that answers Mr. Stewart's question.
Thank you very much, Minister. Thank you, Alexander. Andy Whiteman.
Thanks, Convener. I just should say, for the sake of saving time, that in fact the substance of my questions has already been addressed in the responses to Alexander Stewart and Sarah Boyack, so I have no further questions.
Okay, thanks very much for that, Andy. Sarah, did you want to come back in?
So much to ask here. I suppose the issue is the Minister said that if the committee was to not support his proposals today, that people would be stuck with a 2020 tone date. There's clearly no support for that, and people welcome the fact that the Minister suggested an alternative tone date. But wouldn't you listen to the committee, or indeed the Parliament, if we did reject your proposals today and come back with a different tone date and engage the business community in the discussion that many say they don't feel they've actually had? Thank you, Convener.
Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you, Sarah Boyack. I think the reason we are very strong in our position that the binary choice for the committee today is the one that needs to be considered rather than the other options that we've considered prior to this position is that there is we don't think that 2021 is any better than 2020 when it comes to a tone date. The pressured timescale that there would be, which I referred to in my opening statement for 2021, would be very challenging for assessors with multiple structural and operational obstacles. And that's very strongly emphasised in the Scottish Assessors Association submission to the committee. And also, pointing to the FSB survey in particular, the evidence that there is likely to be in 2021 of the market having caught up is significantly limited. There of course could be evidence, and you know we are trying to be balanced here. But on the basis of what we've seen so far, that survey and other engagement we've had suggests to us that the evidence base in April next year will not have caught up with the reality of what businesses are facing. And particularly, we have to be cognizant of the fact that the pandemic second wave is of course currently underway, unfortunately, and that has meant that there has had to be significant further restrictions under the framework. We do not know how the next months will pan out. Obviously, we hope the levels of the virus will go down. We do not know the consequences of Brexit yet. So the evidence base of the likelihood of the evidence base next spring reflecting what the commercial property market is like is severely constrained, and there are so many unknown factors. So on the balance of risk, we don't think that a 2021 tone date would be any more advantageous in terms of a relative judgment on the evidence than a 2020 tone date. I think, Ian, if you could come in on this point as well, please.
Ian?
Right, I'm sorry, Convener, I was waiting to introduce. Yeah, I think our view is that the evidence between 2020 and 2021, the risks are broadly similar, but the operational risks associated with 2021 are significantly greater with regards to assessors. As Mr. McPherson has pointed out, there are 50,000 material change of circumstance appeals in the system, and bear in mind that assessors normally get 70,000 appeals to deal with over a 3 or 5 year period. The actual distraction, the kind of the workload and the human resource that they will need to devote to the addressing those 50,000 appeals is huge. There's also an issue that in many cases we'd like to know the outcome of those material change of circumstance appeals, because they're likely to set some tone for the next revaluation. So I think it's important to see the two of them in parallel. And as Mr. McPherson alluded to in his opening statement, when we talk about a 1 year tone date, we're actually talking about a 6 month tone date, because from the 1st of April, by September, October, Scottish Government needs the headline high level outcomes from the revaluation in order to inform the budget process to meet the Parliament's budget timetable. So when we talk about a 1 year, it's not really a 1 year timetable. And what assessors have been working to ahead of the planned move to a 1 year tone date in what would be 2025 was that they're starting to move towards a more rolling collection of data. Now, they're comfortable that they can probably get that in place with a delayed tone date to 2022, but there's no chance they would be able to get that in place across the country in time for a tone date of next year. So their data collection obstacles are significant. And it kind of undermines the long-term direction of travel for the Barclay Review. And then finally, and this is a slightly anecdotal but hugely important point, a lot of the evidence held by assessors is actually held in their offices. They're still largely a paper-based system, but a lot of it's held in their offices, and therefore there are practical issues with accessing the data. And this will be the same for private sector agents too. But in the discussions I had with assessors yesterday ahead of today, there's another consideration is that in restricting access to assessors' offices, at the moment, they're having to give priority to their electoral registration officers ahead of the election. The valuation staff access is even further restricted than it currently is. And for those operational reasons, given that the evidence base is broadly comparable for the two tone dates, for those operational reasons, we've advised ministers that the risks of the later of the 2020 tone date are significantly greater.
Okay, thank you very much for that. Keith Brown, you wanted to come in?
Keith? Thanks, Convener. Just very briefly, and I'm more than happy if the Minister wants to respond with a one-word answer in interest of brevity, if he feels able to, just to see if I've got my head round some of the points that have been made correctly. So there's no evidence being led for doing other than it's proposed by the Scottish Government. There's no evidence being put to why that would be a better way to proceed on things. There are real problems with the assessors either going out to properties or even doing the office-based work necessary to bring the tone date forward. The evidence from the FSB, which has got by far the largest number of members, small businesses being the backbone of the Scottish economy, are supportive of what the Scottish Government intends to do. And there is it's similar to what's been done in England and Wales, as I understand it. And the Scottish Government saying it has no intention of coming forward with the earlier with an alternative as proposed, if this is not successful, just to see if I've got that right, because it seems a fairly straightforward case to me.
In the interest of brevity, yes, Mr. Brown, you're... Oh, sorry, Convener.
No, my pleasure, as long as you... Brief answers are great answers. Thanks
in the interest of brevity, yes, Mr. Brown is correct in all those points.
Right, thank you. Okay, that's... All questions have been answered, so we'll go on to agenda item 3, which is formal consideration of motion S5M23058, calling for this committee to recommend approval of the draft valuation, postponement of revaluation, coronavirus, Scotland Order 2020, we have just taken evidence on. I invite the Minister to move the motion and speak to it if he has anything further to add.
Formally moved, Convener.
Thank you very much. Nothing further to add. Right. I invite contributions from members. Type R in the box, and I know that Andy Whiteman said that he'd like to come in at this point.
Thanks very much, Convener. And thank you to Minister for this engagement prior to today. Thank you to all those who have submitted written evidence. This is an important issue, I think, as the Minister recognises, and in a sense the committee is in a rather unfortunate place, given that this was announced in the programme for government. We have a binary choice, and there's no scope really for the committee to explore options, albeit that we may end up in the same place as the minister. That option isn't really easily available. So the process isn't ideal, but we are where we are. I don't accept some of the suppositions and premises set out in the government's submission around, for example, revenue neutrality. Revenue neutrality depends on rates being set. I think it is very important to have regular revaluations that reflect the state of the economy. I think it's unfortunate that we're going to be living, continue to be living with an outdated valuation base from 2015 for the next 2 years under this proposal. But I have found the Minister's comments today helpful. I found the Scottish Government's additional evidence very helpful, and I found the evidence from witnesses extremely helpful as well. And as a result of that, I'm persuaded that, at least on the balance of risk, that the government's approach is the appropriate approach to take, and thus will be supporting the instrument. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. And Sarah, you wanted to come in, and then Alexander.
Yes, thank you very much, Convener. Yeah, well, I agree with Andy Whiteman that the additional evidence we've heard today has been helpful, but it doesn't address all of the issues that we've had in terms of concerns from businesses. And the Minister mentioned the FSB, who did give very useful evidence and made additional points about their concerns about how reliefs work and how the business rates work in terms of their members, many of whom don't get the benefit of reliefs because they're in the supply chain but don't operate out of premises. They've got concerns about how reliefs will continue over the next couple of years because they're already impacted. I think I would have liked to have heard a bit more about the issue of resourcing for assessors, because every time there is a valuation, there are tens of thousands of appeals. And the view from the business community that we've had is that they expect by January, February will be there will have been some test cases and there'll be more clarity by then. Though I still have reservations. I do welcome the additional information, but for me it kind of it emphasises the fact that we have been given a binary choice by the minister. It's his choice to frame it in this way. I don't think that is the best choice. Some businesses are concerned about 2022 rather than 2021, given their either partner businesses or competitors in other parts of the UK. So I still think there are outstanding concerns, and I would be keen to get more, as much as we can, on support for businesses, because it will not just be the what happens in our vote today. There will also be the issue of rates reliefs going forward, huge concerns that these will be tapered. And there was a comment by one of your colleagues that there's important we don't undermine the Barclay review, but ironically that is precisely some of the concerns that businesses have put to us, that they are worried that there might even be a delay even with your proposals of a 2023 revaluation. So there is a real issue about certainty. You've correctly mentioned Brexit. We've got the pandemic. There are just fears going forward that even today, if the committee voted for this and the Parliament supported it, it's not a done deal. And there are major concerns about the future of businesses and the need for effective Scottish Government support going forward. And finally, I would just mention the issue about assessors. Those concerns that you raise are businesses across the country have to face every day, whether they're businesses on site doing works, whether it's key organisations that have had to keep going. So in thinking about how we restart and kickstart our economy, support for assessors is going to be vital going forward. And that could mean financial support to enable them to have the staff. Many businesses and public sector agencies have had to recruit additional staff to deal with the pandemic. And surely that has to be something under consideration by Scottish Government Minister. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Sarah. Alexander?
Thank you, Convener. It has been very useful to hear some of the responses this morning from the Minister and some officials. But I still have serious concerns that we are not supporting the business community as the business community wants. I acknowledge the fact that the Small Business Federation have made some representation, but is it not the case that maybe 80% of their members are not paying rates because of the bonus scheme? And the strong representation we've had from the Chamber of Commerce or the Licensed Trade Association does give me cause for concern that we are not taking on board the main concerns of these business organisations. We should be supporting the business sector, protecting jobs, and ensuring that we can help them through this crisis that we face, convener. So I still have some very strong views and I'm happy that we're given this sort of binary choice this morning by the minister, because I still think that the introduction of a revaluation in 2022 and a tone date of 2021 is what the majority of business communities would appear to seem to want, and we are not respecting that. So I certainly would not be supportive of the minister's proposal this morning.
Okay, thank you very much, Alexander. Minister, would you like to sum up?
Thank you, convener. Just briefly, appreciate the points raised and the indications of Mr. Whiteman's support in particular. I note the points that Sarah Boyack has raised, which are of course all important ones, and we'll consider how not just to, as you would expect, consider the points she raises, which we are, but also what communication would be appropriate for the committee to follow up on those points going forward. And as I say, this is a balance of risk. There is strong support in the business community for our proposal, and we do want to support the business community. That is why we are taking this position. We appreciate there's a difference of opinion out there, but we are determined to work with the business community after today's decision to continue to consider reliefs, which I know the committee is rightly concerned about, as are we, which is of course subject to Barnett consequentials, but we will, after today's decision, work proactively and constructively with the business community on considerations around reliefs and how we move forward towards a robust revaluation taking place as we all work together to come through this crisis and move forward.
Thank you very much, Minister. The question therefore is that motion S5M23058 in the name of the Minister for Public Finance and Migration be approved. Are we all agreed? No. Okay, we're not all agreed. In that case, we will move to a division, and I will do this by roll call. I'll do it in alphabetical order, and I'll be at the end. I will start with Sarah Boyack.
I vote no. Thank you, convener.
Okay, thank you. Keith Brown.
I vote yes, convener.
Gail Ross.
I vote yes, convener.
Alexander Stewart.
I vote no, convener.
Thank you. Annie Wells.
I vote no, convener.
Andy Whiteman.
I vote yes.
And I vote yes, which means that the result is 4-3 for the motion. Thank you very much. I thank the Minister. The committee will report on this instrument in due course, and I invite the committee to delegate authority to me as convener to approve a draft of the report for publication. I thank the Minister and his officials for taking part in the meeting. I will now suspend briefly to allow a witness changeover. Thank you. Thank you, Minister. Item 4 is our first day of evidence on the European Charter of Local Self-Government and Corporations Scotland Bill. And I welcome the following, all attending remotely today. Professor Chris Hemsworth, Emeritus Professor of Administrative Law, the University of Edinburgh. Professor Richard Kerley, Professor of Management, Queen Margaret University. And Alison Payne, Research Director of Reform Scotland. Thank you all for being here today and for your written submissions. For information, we've allocated an hour or thereabouts for this session, and we have a number of issues to discuss with you. So I would ask, if you possibly can, to keep your answers as succinct as they possibly can be. Andy Whiteman, a member in charge, is also a committee member. Under the Parliament's standing orders, he will in fact take part in the evidence session as a non-committee member. In practice, this means I will only allow him to come in at the end for questions to panellists, if time allows. Before we start, some brief technical information. There's a pre-arranged questioning order, and I will call each member in turn to ask their questions for a block of up to 9 minutes. It would help broadcasting if members could indicate who on the panel their questions are addressed to, and we may have a short amount of time for supplementary questions at the end. As there are three people on the panel, please indicate clearly if you wish to answer the question, for instance, by raising your hand, and don't feel the need to answer every question fully if your views are generally in line with points already made. And please could everyone give broadcasting staff a second to operate the microphones before you speak. Thank you, and we will now move on to questions. I suppose this is to all of you. To what extent and how does the bill support the process of further devolution of local government, and what legislative barriers remain? Does anybody wish to kick off? Alison Payne.
Thanks. Thank you very much, Convener, and thank you for this opportunity. I think Reform Scotland see the legislation as a good stepping stone, as a sort of first step on a long-awaited journey towards greater decentralisation. I think it's an important recognition of the value of local government, and I think just where we would come at it is that this has to be just the first step, that we are recognising the value of local government, that we, but it then leads on to greater decentralisation of additional powers and responsibilities, and a sort of balancing of the relationship between Holyrood and our local government.
Okay, thank you. Professor Kerley. Professor. Can you hear me? Professor Kerley?
I'm not getting any of the audio.
Okay. If you could mute Professor Kerley just now, and I'll bring in Professor Hemsworth. Professor Hemsworth.
Hello. Am I on?
Yes, you are. Yeah, indeed.
Thanks very much, and thanks very much for the committee's invitation today. And I think my answer to the question posed is that this bill, as I see it, forms part of the future. I think it must be broadly accepted, has been accepted for many years, that there is always an issue within any of our European countries of the strength and capacity of local authorities to do what they need to do. In Scotland in particular, this has been a familiar refrain ever since, at least in my experience, weekly at the end of the 60s and into the 70s and the reorganisations of that time and so on. And this has been a call sustained through the process of devolution, of course, through McIntosh and so on, and into the existence of the devolved parliament and devolved government in Scotland. So there is a constant issue there of adopting means to support local authorities to support their autonomy within the working constitution. As to this particular response to that problem, then I think although one has to, I think, inevitably take a somewhat pragmatic view to this, it seems to me that incorporation of the Charter is top of the pile at present for various reasons, which I could elaborate on. It has the advantage of being there. It is already, it contains obligations which are already binding on all bodies, relevant bodies within the UK and certainly within Scotland. It's a text available, has been since 1985, available within the UK since 1998. This is, to my mind, a good route forward, but I'm sure there will be more to say about that as we proceed.
I'm sure you're right. I wonder, but could you tell me, where does this leave? Does it leave any other legislative barriers in the way for the further devolution of to local government?
I think, Chairman, if I interpret you correctly, I think this opens the way as necessary to further legislation in the direction of the further, if I'm hesitant to call it liberation of local government, but the further empowerment of local government and further increases in the autonomy of local government. Of course, it stands to encourage all moves in those directions.
Okay, thank you for that. I've got a further question about the South Lanarkshire Council referred to challenging historical decisions around local government financing. Would the bill be seen as an opportunity to challenge past Scottish Government decisions around council funding, and do you think that's what it should be for? Again, I'll stay with you, Professor Hemsworth.
Yes,
as you're on screen.
Right. Well. Thank you. I mean, this. I must just pause a moment just to indicate where the device adopted in this bill is to make the articles of the Charter available within Scotland. They're scheduled. They would be scheduled to the Act were it to be passed. And the consequence of that, I think this is, again, we could expand on this, but I think a consequence of that is the obligation placed on the Scottish Government in particular.
I would hope that it going forward, it would help create a new relationship and a new balancing. And it's the beginning of a new relationship. I think if it ends up getting clogged up in previous grievances, then it's not actually helping lead to a new situation, a better situation, which is then looking at, well, this is the starting point. What powers can we devolve? How can we actually get towards proper decentralisation? I mean, I think that's what we want, the journey going forward, rather than it being so much looking backwards retrospectively.
Yeah, okay, right, I appreciate that. Listen, I'm going to move on. Professor Curley says that he can be heard, he thinks he can be heard now. So, Sarah, you're next with questions, so maybe you could ask Professor Curley one. Thank you very much.
Thanks very much, Convener. Yes, can I first of all say to the three witnesses, thank you so much for your evidence in advance. It's been really helpful to us. I would like to follow up with brief questions. And hopefully, Richard Curley, you might be able to come in. You've talked in the section of your evidence, you talk about dilemmas. And I would like to say, to ask you, how do you think the bill could be improved? Because you've talked about areas where you think there might be improvements that could be made. And I would wonder if you would set that out to us, how you think the bill could be strengthened to make it more effective. Thank you.
Professor Curley. No.
That convener, that was a question I was also going to ask Chris Hemsworth, because he's also mentioned the need to improve the legislation in a number of ways. I wonder if you could come in on that point while we wait for Professor Curley to come back in. So over to you, Professor Hemsworth.
Okay, thank you. Sorry. Yes. I was waiting for the chair's nod. Thank you very much. Thanks for that question. I think that probably principally addresses the earlier points that I was making in my piece of evidence that I submitted, when perhaps I used inappropriately the notion of expanding the scope of the bill. By that, I meant the coverage of the bill. And perhaps I could just explain where I was coming from when I was making those observations. And I think it was this, that the job in hand here is to give effect to the charter in broad terms. What the charter is, and some people have called it a sort of charter of rights for local authorities, what it does is to speak in positive terms about the things that should be achieved on behalf of local government, on behalf of local authorities. What the charter is largely silent on is which bodies are, if you like, the principal threats to that autonomy, to those powers, and how those threats should be addressed. It's simply the manner of presentation of the charter. Now, it's pretty clear in all documents associated with the charter, right from the start, has been that, of course, the principal threats, I'm not meaning this in any deeply unpleasant way, but the principal threats to local autonomy do inevitably come from central government, howsoever defined. And there's no doubt that, of course, in very, very large measure, it is central government, however defined, that has to be body which has principal responsibilities in this area. And in Scotland, inevitably, we think of the Scottish government and the Scottish ministers. What I think has to be borne in mind is that the Charter is anxious to preserve the autonomy and therefore to repel any threats to autonomy wherever they come from. If I could just give one example from the Charter, it's this, that the Charter at a couple of points specifically refers to the obligation or the requirement that local authorities should be consulted on matters which affect them. One of them is an obligation in relation to their financial arrangements and their financing, and the other is a more general obligation to consult as to their functions and the discharge of their functions. And it seems to me that what would inevitably be required, and what the Charter itself would seek to do, is that any bodies, not just the Scottish Government, the Scottish ministers, but other bodies, if you like, close to central government in Scotland, or even a little bit more distant, but nevertheless bodies which have dealings with local authorities, also would be expected to respect those obligations under the Charter. So, for instance, if there are, of course, health authorities in Scotland, there is Police Scotland and the Police Authority in Scotland, and so on, many others. When they do things, then there, of course, it's a perfectly familiar thing that they should consult with local authorities as necessary. This Charter would reinforce those obligations. Now, the approach taken in the bill, and I think this is a perfectly legitimate approach. It is to focus almost exclusively, I think, on the obligations of the Scottish ministers, and I think that's right. Because they are the ones who have the principal responsibilities in this field. There's no doubt about that. And the whole structure of the bill is around imposing obligations on them, their response, and to an extent, enforcing that that response. All I was inviting was discussion of whether that coverage of the bill, if you like, might be viewed as expandable to cover the obligations of other public authorities in Scotland, and that's what my little questions in my paper were inviting discussion of. Now, I do also understand that one or two of the suggestions I made, and perhaps I was just flying kites a little here, do raise questions about competence, legislative competence of the Parliament, and there may be a lot of very good prudential reasons for avoiding any difficulties in those areas, and therefore that I can well understand that the Parliament would wish to avoid inviting completely unnecessary, to my mind, challenge on competence grounds. And so I'm not at all pressing for that. On the other hand, can I just mention one?
Very quickly. On you go.
Well, if other public bodies completely within the competence of the Scottish Parliament were to be brought within the embrace of the bill, then that would not be a wholly bad thing, to my mind, for the reasons that I've said. But of course, I can see that it does complicate the bill in some measure. Would complicate the bill. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm sorry.
No, not at all. Sarah, Professor Kelly is meant to be on audio only. Do you want to try him?
Yes, it was the follow-up. I appreciate the comment we've had from Professor Hemsworth. It was, again, to ask about how the bill could be improved. I get the sense from both Professor Curley and from Alison Payne that they are strongly in support of the bill, but it's just what are the strengthening elements they think should be added to the bill? Thank you, Convener.
Okay, I'm hoping that people can hear me now. Could somebody give an indication that
you've
got me? Thank you. And if I do break up, then I'm happy to write down the response. I had not previously considered the case that Professor Hemsworth has made in his written evidence and just now about the incorporation of other government agencies and bodies within the bill. That, I have to say, makes a lot of sense to me, but my starting point was the simply the adoption of the Charter would be a marvellous way of showing both respect and the long sought for parity of esteem in terms of the elected position of local authorities throughout Scotland. And I think it would be a reminder to both members of the Parliament and government ministers about decisions that are made, legislation that is created, has to take account of those different spheres of elected democratic legitimacy. So I would personally not go for a much longer, more complex bill. If what Chris Hemsworth has said could be captured in a clause, it makes a great deal of sense to me, but I wouldn't go for a long, detailed addition or schedules to the bill that would attempt to delineate every possible agency. I mean, I think his point is a very powerful one in terms of Police Scotland, of the health boards, of Education Scotland, which clearly has recently got itself into some tangle with what different local authorities are doing. The end of my answer.
Okay.
Thank you. And to Alison Payne, I suppose the issue is, does the bill deliver what Chris Hemsworth was suggesting it needs to deliver, and does it need to be amended, or is the bill strong enough as it is? Thank you.
Thank you, Deputy Convener. I think Reform Scotland would agree with what Professor Curley said about the importance of this creating a sort of respect and parity of esteem platform. We would certainly agree with Professor Hemsworth, and indeed Reform Scotland have talked before about the issues about where healthcare, health boards and the overlap with local government, or Police Scotland and the overlap with local government, and how local government has been gradually squeezed out of other areas. Those are definitely important issues that need to be considered. However, I'd be concerned about anything that would overly complicate the bill, and that our priority is that the bill is a good starting platform, and that our priority would be to get the bill through, and then it's about what comes next and how we build those new relationships.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Sarah. Alexander?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. I know time is tight, so I'll maybe ask two questions and one, Convener, and the panel can then respond. My first question would be about the strengthening of the legislation. Do we believe that it would be strengthened by the appointment of an overseeing commissioner? And what about the views on potential sanctions? To what extent might they be needed? And what form might some of these sanctions take? Thank you, Convener. Any of the panel who wish to answer?
Professor Kelly, do you want to start if you are available?
Yeah. Yes, Convener. A very interesting question, and it's raised in your earlier consideration of this bill. I do not favour the appointment of a commissioner because I think that the simple direct measure of access to the legal process would be impeded by having, we refer it to a commissioner and the person concerned might then say yes or no, and the local authorities or other agencies concerned might then say, well, we wish to challenge that as we believe we have a right to do. I think direct access to the legal system is a more powerful mechanism. I have very little enthusiasm for sanctions of any kind to be levied against public bodies, whether it be the Parliament or indeed the government, because sanctions can take, the nuclear form is debarment from office, and we abandoned that a while ago, apart from exceptional cases. What would we do? Fine a public agency? And if we did, then we'd simply be removing monies from one agency to presumably lodge somewhere else. So neither commissioner nor sanction for me.
Okay.
And, thank you.
Alison?
Thank you. We would largely agree with what Professor Curley said. I think that the importance is the symbolism of the legislation, that we're trying to build a new relationship. And I think if it's descending into sanctions and tit for tat, it's not where we're wanting to go. I think it's about building a new respect agenda.
Okay, thank you. Professor Hemsworth?
Yes, thank you, Chairman. And I think I follow on those remarks. As to a commissioner, I suppose the offering of complaints systems, which is what that might become in a way across public authorities in Scotland, has become something of an industry in recent years. Perhaps at the centre of this is the Ombudsman as a channel for entertaining complaints from different sources across the public services in Scotland. However, I think in this case, I would first and foremost say this is not appropriate business for the Ombudsman, even though a general stance has been taken in recent years that rather than further clutter the administrative environment, one should use the known resources available. But I don't think this is myself Ombudsman work. I could elaborate on that, but that's my view. And I think that otherwise, I do think that the directness of simply the imposition of the requirements, the obligations, the compatibility obligations that the bill does on the principal target, the Scottish ministers, the best thing. As to sanctions, I'm not quite sure what that means. Yes, of course. I mean, it could ultimately mean that the steps taken by the Scottish ministers are incompatible with the charter, and that something would need to be done about that, and the courts could make what the bill calls a declaration of incompatibility, and this would impose, if you like, sanctions, obligations on ministers. Not of course in a personal sense. I mean, it would simply be an institutional obligation as ever by ministers. I wonder if I could just mention, because I failed to mention earlier, historical. It's most unlikely, I think, that deeply historical challenges would ever be competent under this bill. I mean, for all the sorts of reasons, access to the courts and access to judicial review to enforce this act would be most unlikely, I think, to penetrate deep into the history of financial allocations, but would have to be triggered pretty promptly if there were a complaint.
Okay, thank you very much, Alexander.
I mean, convener, that's fine. I'm content. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that, Alexander. Keith Brown.
I've got one question for each of the panelists, and the first one is to Professor Hinsworth. And each of the questions is about really whether the bill will have the effect that those that support it would like it to have. And for Professor Hinsworth, it's really the interesting point that he's made about whether other bodies should be captured by this as well. Just by reference to the example, say a city deal is signed by the UK government, the Scottish government, and a local authority or local authorities. And within that deal, the local authority feels very aggrieved that the UK government, for example, has completely failed to take into account the interests and the views of that local authority and which projects it's going to support. Not a far-fetched example. Where would this bill help? The Scottish government would be bound by the same agreement, and would it be the case that the only action that can be taken by an aggrieved local authority would be against the Scottish government, even though, in their view, the fault would lie with the UK government?
Yeah, thank you very much. These are, of course, difficult areas. Look, my whole talk, expanded talk about embracing, for instance, obligations on UK ministers do raise those questions of competence that I raised earlier, and it would and whether they were covered at all by the bill would depend on the bill's terms. At the moment, they're plainly not. And therefore the bill would make no direct contribution in that area. In any event, it sounds to me as though the sort of complaints that might be raised under city deal arrangements would be better dealt with under other forms. The only way that the charter would add anything directly to that would be perhaps to invoke the requirements of the charter that authorities are adequately funded, and for instance that there are systems of equalisation and so on in place within the financing system. And I suppose there's just an outside chance, but I would rate it no more highly than that, an outside chance that equalisation and notions of equalisation might enter into that sort of debate. I'll stop for a moment. I'm not sure whether I've answered the question wholly, but I'm happy to come back.
Keith.
Yeah, I think it's just really about the legal jeopardy of the aggrieved action being undertaken by one public body, but the only people that local authorities could take action against would be the public body which is bound in its law. But leaving that to one side, I have put in the chat bar to Professor Kerley a couple of questions when I wasn't sure if he was going to get the audio. Obviously, the first part of it, Professor Kerley's answered, wouldn't support a commissioner, and I would certainly agree with that. My second question, just for the benefit of the public record, I suppose, is really about the evidence that Professor Kerley gave, where he said, and I'm paraphrasing him, feel free to contradict me, that some of the language in the Charter really allows the government to escape by reference to national economic frameworks or the other such phrases from any real accountability. And if that's his view, and feel free to contradict it, how then does this become anything more than just a dead letter, I suppose?
Thank you very much, Mr. Brown. I've answered the first question, as you've just acknowledged, orally. In relation to the second one, the point I was hoping to make is that the variety of systems of local government, and indeed the degree of democratic accountability, as we would understand it in the various parts of the United Kingdom, very wide and very varied, given the number of countries that have signed up to this charter. So the charter had to accommodate that in many, many different ways. As I read it, and as we see from experience in other countries, there is nothing to prevent a nation state government from taking action to change local governments or to vary the amount of responsibility or indeed the resources that are transferred through various financial schemes to different local governments, as long as they are done properly and legally in terms of the legal framework within that particular country. And I give the example of the reduction of local authorities in Sweden over a number of decades. There's nothing freezes in aspic the current arrangements that exist. So I wouldn't say it's a dead letter. The point I would want to make is that a course of action has to be justified, has to be legislated for, that's within the terms of the law, and preferably has to be discussed and agreed with the variety of interests concerned with both local self-government and the totality of government and decision-making within the country, within Scotland. That's the end of my answer, Convener.
Thank you very much. Keith?
Yeah, thanks for that. I think my kind of skepticism about how effective it might be is probably informed by the last time I studied these things in the 1980s and the various challenges between local governments and the UK government at that time about powers and changes. However, my last question is to Alison Payne, and just to say, if there is a degree of scepticism about the actual impact that this charter would have, and I'm thinking about people in local government, would it not be the case other things? For example, they propose perhaps full-time, properly remunerated posts for councillors would be far more effective in enhancing parity of esteem and effectiveness in local government to withstand the predations of national government than this charter.
Thank you for that. I don't think it's one or the other. I mean, we would undoubtedly not say that this bill on its own is enough. It has to be a first step. And I think that it's an important signalling that on a path to, I mean, one of the areas that we feel over the course of devolution is that powers have been sort of centralised at Holyrood, and we need more devolution. We need to look at local government and we need to value it more highly. And I think there are a number of the issues there that you've highlighted in terms of full-time enumerated councillors and other how we strengthen local government. It certainly goes beyond just this bill. We would agree that this bill on its own is certainly not enough. And I think in our evidence, we said that this has to be only the first step. There's a lot of things that we would like the Scottish Government to do. And we've at Reform Scotland have called for a long time about looking in terms of local taxation and other areas of power and how we give local government a far greater say in terms of health and policing. These issues all still need to be dealt with, but we still welcome the bill as an important first step, if you like.
Thank you.
OK, thank you, Keith. Gail?
Thank you, Convener. Yeah, it leads actually really nicely on. I was going to ask Alison about the centralisation and how she saw the next steps. So I'll drill down a little bit further into that, if you don't mind. Alison, you talked about non-domestic rates and tax in your submission. And you spoke about that just now. But the reforms that you're looking for, are they possible without the bill? And how does the bill fit in to then act as a springboard to go on and have more, I think it was Professor Curley that said, parity of esteem, and Professor Hemsworth said it was a stepping stone on a journey. So I just wonder, you know, where it fits in, and would that journey take place without this bill?
Thank you. I think those reforms could certainly take place without the bill. At Reform Scotland, we've been calling for them pretty much since our creation back in 2008. But I think the bill is certainly important in terms of a stepping stone to reset the relationship between central and local government. I think the fact that it calls on the Scottish Government having to report about its relationship and how it's been how it's taken into account local government, I think it is an important reminder of the relationship and the importance of that relationship, and that local government shouldn't just be put to the side. And I hope it will help be a springboard. I do think that we need to consider issues, and I think the current pandemic has reminded us of that. I mean, if we have the different tiers, the current situation, both in terms of health and economic output, has been affected differently throughout the country, and we need our local authorities to be able to respond to that. So I think the current economic climate also means that together with this bill, hopefully we can begin to have a reset of that relationship between local and central government in Scotland. And the next stages, if you like, we would like to see reviewing local government finance, for example, and properly looking to start decentralising powers.
And are there any... Thanks, sorry, convener. Are there any specific powers then, apart from the non-domestic rates and tax that you spoke about, that you would also like to see come into local government? And what's your opinion on, apologies, convener, but I'm going to get a little parochial here, the size of some local authorities, for example, mine in Highland, and how can they really be close to the people when they cover a landmass of more of half of Scotland?
And undoubtedly, there's a huge variance across the country in terms of, you've got, you know, from Clackmannanshire to the Highlands, of covering huge different geographies or population levels as well. And I think that there's definitely a lot of different issues that can be considered. And I think we're beginning to see small local authorities are choosing to work together. But I think what we want to see is things changing from the bottom up. So in certain areas where there's huge geography, how we can look at bringing decisions beyond the local government area, so that you can look at whether it's area committees or how you can strengthen community councils, but how you can bring decisions closer to the people. So it doesn't stop at local government. It goes beyond that. And I think we need to have a sort of full national conversation as to how we re-engage people into local government. In terms of your question about the powers, we've specifically mentioned in our evidence about the tax powers, council tax and business rate, but we would also look at how can we re-inject a greater level of localism into policing. We now have just the one police body covering Scotland. How do we ensure that, improve that local government representation in there? And in terms of health boards, we've said before there's things that we can do where you can at least pilot initiatives. If you look at where the health board areas and the local government areas cover the same areas, you can look at doing things that they're bringing things closer together. So we think there's a lot of things that we should be looking at as to how we can improve the structure of local government, make it more accountable to individuals, better engage the communities they serve as well, because I think there can be a disconnect as to where does responsibility is the person that should be accountable for decision making, whose fault or who is to be congratulated for a policy is getting a wee bit lost. And I think we do need to have a broad conversation about local government in Scotland.
Okay, thank you. Professor Hemsworth or Professor Curley, would you like to come in?
Chairman?
Yes. Chris, do you want to go first?
Thank you very much, Chairman. And yes, and further to endorse those those sentiments, I think. I think I've always seen the Charter as principally making a principal contribution to the environment, if you like, within which these issues, which inevitably arise, always have, between local authorities and, as represented by COSLA, and central government, that this contributes to the debate. It contributes to the debate by providing the standards. It's a standard-setting exercise which the Charter embarks upon, according to which the debate should be conducted. It's a cliche, I suppose, nowadays to say that individual pieces of legislation are never, or of policy, are never silver bullets, and nobody's going to claim that this Charter or the incorporation of this Charter is a silver bullet to the solution to all problems about local government in Scotland. Of course not. But it goes well beyond, potentially, I think, the contribution that it makes to framing that environment than being, if you like, merely symbolic visible only as utter generalities. For instance, to just re-engage with the financial debate, it is Article 9.3 of the Charter that insists on local government having available a source of revenue over which they have the power to determine the rate, as the Charter says. And a comment on the present arrangements is that those arrangements are pretty precarious at the moment when measured against that test. The business rates have long since been taken out of the hands of the local authorities. As long as you have the measures taken to suppress the freedom of local authorities to make council tax decisions at will, then you remove from them the power to determine the rate in effect, and I think therefore that it shows that the Charter does seek to address and would provide that framework within which that familiar debate has been conducted and will continue to be conducted. Chairman, thank you.
Professor Keller.
Gail Russman raises some very interesting questions, some of which have long been, to my mind, quite hard to reconcile. So you either, for example, have a very large geographic area for a local authority, which is sparsely populated, and if you think Highland is big, you should see some of the local authority areas in Australia, Canada, and parts of the United States. Or you have a number of small local authorities with very few people. And the reality of that is that in any collective discussion within the policy community, in the broadest sense, Glasgow, Edinburgh, Aberdeen, and Fife completely outweigh Nairn or wherever it might be. So there's a hard to reconcile balance in some of that. But I'd want us, and I would like and hope the committee will focus on this particular piece of legislation at the moment. There are many other things that we could do, and I might suggest we do in relation to local government. But this, I think the point made by both Alison and Chris Hemsworth is that we are helping to create more of a climate of a working relationship between central and local government if this bill were to be approved by the Parliament. And I don't think that stops us arguing for alternative courses of action on, for example, non-domestic rates and on the forms of local taxation that we have for citizens and I think it's inescapable in some shape or form for residential property. But I'd like it to focus on this particular bill rather than on what we might otherwise do by a far larger bill, which I arguably would be the province of the government to introduce, not a private member with respect to Andy Whiteman. This strikes me as a member's bill. It focuses on a particular aspect of, I'm moving my hands, convener, to show the wider context. And I think that's in the spirit of such legislation. End of my comment.
Thank you very much. Gail, you've got a very brief question to ask.
It's so small, convener. Thank you. It's to Professor Hems. Just on the back of the conversation about taxation and council tax and councils being given the freedom to set their own rates, how would the Scottish Government's council tax freeze then fit into the whole, I guess, ability for councils to want to set their own rates, but then being told nationally that they had to adhere to a national policy?
Yes, if I may, Chairman. Yes. I think that was indeed one aspect of the current constraints on local authorities, which are operative at the minute. The Charter, I might say, looks beyond, if you like, the terms, simply the terms of national legislation when judging whether the standards have been met. In other words, it won't simply say section whichever it is of I haven't got it in mind, of the Local Government Act, which authorises local authorities freely to decide on the level of the council tax rate. That is far from sufficient. What they're looking for is for the practical implementation of the Charter, and it's that has always been had in mind when the other means, the international means, if you like, for the scrutiny of the Charter and its implementation has been undertaken from Strasbourg by the Council of Europe through Congress of Local and Regional Authorities. They're looking all the time, not merely at statutory frameworks for freedom, but for the practical operation. Now, my observation was simply that the practical conclusion of arrangements at the minute leave individual authorities without much wriggle room at all in the setting of their levels of funding. They have, of course, other charges available to them and so on, which they may have greater freedom with. But as to the principal sources of revenue, not much is there. And therefore, I mean, it would seem to me that it's always been there. This Charter has been, even if not incorporated, has been there, if like, available to be invoked by local authorities and by COSLA, and they have done so over the years. This would strengthen the ability for recourse to that particular rule within the Charter, principle within the Charter, that would again, contribute to the framing of that particular debate about funding levels.
Okay, thank you.
Professor Kelly, you wanted to come
in. In relation to that specific question. And it echoes the point I was trying to make earlier, that if you look at the full list of signatories to the Charter and those aspects of the Charter to which they have committed themselves, you'll find there's considerable variation indeed in terms of the list of signatories. Some of them are fairly, I can't think of the right word, interesting places, one of which includes Armenia, Azerbaijan, Andorra. You just start on the A's and you're looking at places very different from Scotland or the rest of the United Kingdom or France or wherever. The second point, and I've always argued that the standstill on council tax, which I did not agree with, incidentally, in many ways, was not technically a freeze. It was that local authorities tended, unwisely in my view, to financial incentives to keep the council tax at a standstill level. That's why the amount of increase was fairly consistent with previous legal judgments. So, you know, if local authorities collectively agree to something with the government, then it's whether it's imposed or not. I mean, in its latter stages, it became unpopular with local authorities and imposed. but I don't think it was ever initially a complete imposition. It was an agreement. The Concordat, I mean, historically, the word Concordat doesn't have a lot to recommend it, but there you go. And I'll end there, convener.
Thank you very much. Annie Wills.
Thanks, convener, and good morning, everyone. I've just got one short question. I know we're tight on time, but it is, what would the impact of this legislation have on human rights, and what may be needed to ensure positive outcomes?
I'm sorry, I didn't hear that. Who was being called upon?
Alison.
Sorry, I missed that. The human rights side of things is very short. We don't see any problem to that. It's not something that we've looked into, and so we'd have nothing to add on that bit.
Okay, thank you. Professor Curley?
Yes, I don't see that the legislation as proposed at the moment has any negative impact on human rights at all. I think if we have greater clarity of relationships between different spheres of governance within the country, we actually enhance human rights because we enable people to be clear about what powers and authority and what responsibilities different bodies have, and they then have a greater sense of whether that is impacting on them lawfully and properly, as opposed to just negatively or positively. End of my answer.
Thank you very much. Professor Hemsworth.
Yes, I would agree with that. I referred a little loosely to this charter as a charter of rights for local authorities, and that I would see it as, in that respect, entirely complementary to the other human rights instruments, the other rights instruments that are available internationally. There is an overlapping element if one were seeking one, and that is that you don't have to go far into the European Convention on Human Rights to get to a right to vote. And the notion that local authorities are, of course, locally elected authorities, and that is the basis on which they secure their mandate, secure their legitimacy, their difference, of course, from all those other appointed bodies through the right to vote, is a parallel between the two systems, which I think is worth noting. Thank you, Chairman.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, convener. That's me for brevity.
Thank you. And that allows you to come in with a question, Andy, if you have one.
I've got no questions, convener.
Thank you very much. Today we have seen a first. On that note, can I just thank you very much for taking part. That completes the end of our questions for the first panel. Members of the panel can leave the meeting by pressing the red telephone icon. And thank you all very much for your participation this morning. I suspend the meeting for a panel changeover. Welcome back. I am pleased to welcome our second panel of witnesses who are attending remotely today. Andrew Fraser, Head of Democratic Services, North Ayrshire Council, representing Society of Local Authority Lawyers and Administrators, SOLAR. Councillor Alison Everson, President of COSLA, and Councillor Malcolm Bell, Convener of Shetland Islands Council. Thanks for being in attendance today and thanks for your written evidence. We've again allocated around an hour for this session. You may have heard my remarks to the last panel that if you agree with what a panellist has already said, please feel free simply to confirm this rather than give a full answer. Members will again ask their questions in a pre-arranged order with any supplementaries at the end if time allows. It would help broadcasting if members could indicate who in the panel their questions are addressed to. And please give broadcasting staff a second to operate your microphones before you speak. And Councillor Everson, I believe you have some brief opening remarks.
Yes, thank you, Chair. Thank you. The UK ratified the European Charter of Local Self-Government as it is an international treaty of the Council of Europe almost three decades ago. COSLA has been urging the UK government and since devolution the Scottish Government and Parliament to bring it to domestic legislation so it enters into force. Scotland, Wales and England are the only countries in Europe, other than Hungary, that do not recognise the right to local self-government in its domestic legal framework. That is what incorporating the Charter is all about. It is a rare oddity that Scotland, with over 600 years of uninterrupted local government history, has not yet held itself to the same standard as other countries in Europe. Furthermore, at a moment when the UK has left the EU, passing this bill will ensure that Scotland keeps pace with the standard of the other European organisation, the Council of Europe, of which the UK was one of the founders. Incorporating the Charter would bring about a new level of partnership working on shared issues with a positive impact on outcomes. It would be like legislation on inequalities, with the law being a legal backstop for governments. Next year, the Congress of Local and Regional Authorities of the Council of Europe, which is responsible for monitoring the application of the Charter, and where Councillor Heather Brannan McVeigh and Angela Constance MSP represent Scotland, will come to Scotland to examine the state of our local democracy. What a better sign than to welcome them with this bill already on the statute book. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Councillor Everson. I will now begin by asking the panel, same question as I asked the first one, to what extent and how does the bill support the process of further devolution of local government and what legislative barriers remain? Councillor Everson, do you want to kick that off?
Yes, thank you. This bill is about a really important culture change. It's about ensuring that we have that relationship on a firm and partnership footing between Scottish Government and local government. And therefore, it's about empowering local government to have that role. At the moment, for example, when the Scottish Government wants to introduce a new piece of legislation, there's an awful lot of thinking goes on before local government is consulted. If we can have this legislation in practice, it means that local government would be there involved in decision making to have better outcomes and better results for all our communities that we all together serve. This is a really important stage in moving on that next step of devolution, that next step of democracy in Scotland that was first established with the Scottish Parliament. It's about moving us on. It's about that important next step. It's about making sure that our communities are more empowered to take part in decision making and taking that democracy right down to the lowest level within our communities and encouraging people to feel empowered and get involved. By encouraging more participative democracy, which we would through this legislation, we would be enhancing the work in our local communities and all of us would be getting the better outcomes that we seek and we are looking for. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Mr. Fraser, do you want to come in?
Thanks very much. I think there is a slight danger that we exaggerate what the bill actually does. I think it's important to recognise the Charter came into effect in 1998. The government, as I understand it, have committed to comply with it. So in theory, these duties should be something which are already being complied with. Essentially, I would agree with the submissions of both Alison's, this is very much about culture change, building on that new relationship. It feeds into that overall debate about what sort of country do we want Scotland to be. You know, do we want it to be a rights-based one, you know, one which takes its international obligations seriously, where all organisations work in partnership, hopefully towards a common aim. And this, I think, is very much, it's unfinished business. It's part of that starting point of building more consensus. And I think the corollary of that, in some ways, the opposite, is that if Parliament doesn't support this bill, it sends out a really bad message about the commitment to subsidiarity, about, you know, the forthcoming review of local governance, and you know, the degree to which there is a commitment to depart from that kind of command and control central model. And I suppose being bedfellows with Hungary really isn't a good place to be when the charter is going to be subject to review next year. So I think this is a starting point. It's one of the important points of the journey down the road. And it's a good first win when it comes to the local governance review. And I think many of the issues that have been raised by the committee are wider issues about the local governance review, which are extremely important. But I don't think the charter will answer those at this stage. Thanks.
Okay. Thank you for that. Councillor Bell.
Convener, and thank you for the opportunity to appear before you today. I would echo what the previous speakers have said, that the bill in itself won't be transformative, but it's a very important first step along the road in changing the direction of travel, the direction of travel that we've been on for decades now, because this is not party political in any sense. And I guess my question would be, why wouldn't we adopt this? Scotland likes to think of itself as a very European nation, and that's an aspiration that I agree with. But in terms of its centralisation habits, it's actually a very British nation. And I think this bill, the adoption of this bill, would go a long way to changing that perception. Thank you, Convener.
Sorry, can I just clarify there that you're saying this bill would go a long way to change the perception of us being a British nation or a European nation?
No, what I'm saying is we like to think of ourselves as a European nation, rightly so. I agree with that aspiration. But in terms of the centralisation habits of Scotland as a nation, centralising things, taking things into the centre, very top down, it's actually acts like in a very British way, if I may say.
Right. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Thank you very much for that. I was just looking for that clarification. That was all. I wonder, where some of the ambiguity in charter articles could be cleared up in legislation. It's a question I've got for you. I wonder, Andrew Fraser, do you want to come into that?
I think inevitably the charter articles are in broad terms. As I've said before, I think this is very much about building that culture and ensuring that people have regard to the Charter as a starting point. You know, maybe a good example might be the Charter obligation which relates to ring fencing, which is 9.7. You know, it says, as far as possible, grants to local authorities shall not be earmarked for the financing of specific projects. Now, that isn't a bar to ring fencing, but it just means that the as far as possible test has to be addressed and considered. So I think it's a good example. It's almost a bit like equalities. It's asking for consideration of the charter before peeping for consultation. Hopefully that helps.
Okay. Yeah, that's fair. Councillor Everson, you want to come on?
Yes, I'll echo the comments just made by Andrew Fraser there. It's about making sure that local government is consulted, that the interests of local government are considered. It's not about saying yes, you shall do this, or no, you shan't do that. It's about involving that consultation. It is involving that together thinking. And if you think that 61% of the national performance framework is delivered by local government, you see the importance of having that consultation and that involvement and participation together. So the charter allows it makes sure that we can have that discussion, make sure that local government is considered before decisions are made. And that's the important thing. It's about refocusing that relationship between central and local government for the better outcomes for our communities. And the bottom line is we're all serving the same communities.
That's definitely true. Can I ask then, I suppose, I'll ask Councillor Bell first, I'm kind of running out of time, but it appears from what has been said that the purpose of this bill is really just to send out a message that already the stuff that we are being asked to do under this bill we've been doing for a number of decades, according to certainly what Councillor Bell and one of the other questioners suggested, Andrew Fraser. Would that be the case? Is this really just about sending out a message, or are there real practical applications to this bill?
Thanks, Convener. I mean, I don't think I certainly didn't mean to say that we've been doing things right for decades. I mean, I think for decades, my apologies, I may have worded it wrongly, but I mean, certainly for decades, the power and the influence of local government has been eroded, has been chipped away. And as I said earlier, that's not a party political statement. It's happened under governments of all hues in Edinburgh and in Westminster. So, for example, in the last 4 or 5 decades, we've lost power over public health, we've lost water and sewage, we've lost police, the fire services. Education is now largely directed from Edinburgh. It looks as if we may well lose.
Councillor Bell, how would this bill bring any of them back into local government control?
Well, it wouldn't in itself, but what it would do was send out a signal that the government takes its relationship with local government seriously, and at the moment we don't feel that. We feel undervalued, we feel underfunded, and we feel very much under the authority of Holyrood as opposed to being a partner. And I think things actually started off really well in 2007 when we had the Concordat. We had a real feeling that we were entering into a partnership, and for a number of years that did work well, and that probably links back to what previous speakers have said, regarding how the council tax freeze, for example, was readily accepted, because at that time we did have what felt like a real partnership, but over the years that feeling has eroded, and I think it's possibly, well, not possibly, certainly the COVID situation has accelerated that.
Okay, I could have a discussion here with you, but I have run out of time, so I'm hoping that some of the others will pick up on some of those issues. Sarah?
Thank you, Convener. Again, can I thank the witnesses for their evidence in advance of our committee meeting. In the previous panel, there was a suggestion that the bill will reset relationships between the Scottish and local governments 20 years on since the establishment of the Parliament. I'll be interested in the witnesses' views on whether this is a transformative bill in terms of partnership working between the Scottish Government and local government, and if all the written evidence that makes that assumption is going to be correct. Can I maybe kick off with Alison Everson first?
Yes, thank you. I think this bill has the potential to be transformative in the sense that it is the first step on a transformative journey. It makes that it possible to have a rephrasing of that relationship between Scottish Government and local government. It gives that sense of confidence that local government's voice is being heard, and that in itself will encourage local democracy. It will encourage people to stand forward and participate in that democracy, and I think as a result of that we'll see a more diverse range of people wanting to get involved in local government, wanting to serve their communities, and that in itself will be of huge benefit for us as as a system of government across the two spheres of government in Scotland. So I think it has a huge potential to do something that's great, to be the first step on the journey. And I think to maybe pick up on a point that was just made as well, this isn't about what this particular Scottish government might do, might not do, what its wishes might be, what its aspirations might be. This is about enshrining something in law, so it's always there. This isn't about particular policies that might happen, might come about. This is about making sure that we have that relationship set up, always there, always something we can hold on to, that we know we can have those conversations, that we've got that security, that we've got that confidence. And in doing so, we will have people who are feeling more power to get involved, and therefore we will have better outcomes for all our communities.
Thanks. And the other two witnesses, maybe Councillor Bell first. You think we need that reset of relationships? Does the bill do this for us?
Thanks, Deputy Convener. Yeah, I mean, I think I agree very much with what Councillor Everson has said. I don't really have much more to add to it. I don't think we can pass the bill, or you can pass the bill, and that changes the world overnight. It is a signal, and both local government and national government has to work on the relationship, and I think that's to the benefit of both parties, and indeed to the communities that we serve. I mean, I think what I really want to see is the esteem of local government improved and brought up. I mean, at the last election in 2017, we had 3 out of 7 seats in Shetland effectively uncontested. Now, that's the first time that's happened. That's a real concern. If that trend continues, you know, we may well struggle to fill seats, never mind the uncontested, have uncontested seats. And there may well be a lot of reasons for that, but I'm sure one of the reasons is that people don't see the value of local government. And I think this bill, the passing of this bill, would send out a very clear signal that local government is valued as a partner in the overall governance of Scotland. Thanks, David.
Thanks. And Andrew Fraser, I mean, people quite often say, you know, what's the point, because the government sets the finance. Do you think this bill's a game changer?
Yeah, I think it is transformative for a couple of reasons. As I've said, it doesn't impose new duties at all. However, I think awareness of the charter duties was very poor. You know, both within the local government community as well as central government as well. I think once the bill comes through, awareness of those duties will become serious and become a reality, and that can only help. I think the other thing, to not agree the bill, similarly, you know, there's a danger that's equally transformative by sending out a message that there's a lack of commitment to the charter. I suppose from my perspective, if the charter is something that you know, governments should have been implementing anyway, it should really be no big deal to implement this bill. As I say, it fits very well within that rights-based framework.
Yep. Thank you. And if I have time for a brief supplementary, convener, could I ask Alison Everson, are there changes that COSLA feel should be made to the bill to make it as effective as it needs to be? I think there's a reference to the fact that you've got thoughts about how details could be amended, or how the charter's worded. Are there any changes you would like to make to the bill as it's proposed to us?
No, COSLA Local Government is happy with the bill as it is. I think it's really important that we don't complicate matters. The charter was written, it was ratified, as we said, 3 decades ago, and obviously that ratification was accepted at that point. It's important we move on with this journey. The charter is there, let's ratify it, let's enshrine it in our law, let's move forward with it, and then look positively at the democracy across Scotland. The bill is fine as it is.
Okay. Thanks, Sarah.
Thank you, Convener.
Annie else?
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, everyone. South Lanarkshire Council referred to challenging historical decisions around local government funding. Might this bill be seen as an opportunity to challenge past Scottish governments regarding decisions about council funding. Probably one for Alison first, actually.
Yes, thank you, convener, thank you. Yes, the bill is, as has been said in the previous panel as well, the bill is about recalibrating that relationship between Scottish Government and local government. It's about moving forward. We're looking at something ahead of us, not something behind us. And I think that's the important point of this bill. There's been ways that different things can be challenged in the past. The courts have been there already in for judicial reviews and things like that. This is about the forward looking. This is about the future. And I think all of us, the onus on all of us, is to take our responsibility for that relationship and to move forward together in partnership to do something that's enhancing the role of local government, enhancing therefore our communities as well, and moving forward. We're not looking back, we're looking forward. Thank you.
Thanks.
Right, anybody else want to come in on that? Mr. Fraser.
Thanks. Yeah, this is probably not the answer you'd expect from a local government lawyer, but I think the chance of judicial challenge is minimal, really. I think, as Solar said in our response, it's very much the nuclear option that nobody wants to do. I think the chances of success would be relatively poor as long as the Scottish Government could show it had due regard to the principles in the Charter in weighing up the options. I think nobody wants to get to that place. So I think the amount of legal action would be minimal.
Okay, thank you very much. Annie?
Thanks very much, and thanks very much for that answer. And I do like Councillor Everson's, this is about moving forward. So yes, absolutely. So the other thing I wanted to ask was, what do you see the role of the Scottish Parliament and the Local Government Committee being? Will this just be to scrutinise 5-yearly reports under Section 3, or could it go further, as some submissions suggest, with the bill enacted, is there a possibility the Local Government Committee will become less central when it comes to examining the role of local government in Scotland, with this role passing more to the courts?
Councillor Bell, do you want to come in first?
No, not at all. I mean, I would suggest that the courts would have a minimal role here. Yes, that they are there as an option, but it's very much a nuclear option, and as an option we have already in any event, and as one that's used sometimes, but very, very rarely. So I don't see that changing. And this is very much, as I and previous panellists have commented, very much about working in partnership for the benefit of our communities. Thanks.
Mr. Fraser, have you got anything to add?
Entirely. I think the most the courts would do in a particular case is probably provide a bit of clarity around the meaning of one of the Charter obligations. I don't see them in any way usurping or taking away from the role of the committee, or indeed the working relationship between COSLA and government, which I think will improve even more.
Okay.
If I have no further questions, convener.
Okay, thank you very much. Can I just say, it's not a good selling point to suggest that we do away with the local government committee. If you're trying to get us to pass this bill, that's okay. Gail.
Thanks, convener. What a time to come in. There's been a lot made of the relationship between central government and local government, and that probably goes further then to the local government, the relationship between officers and elected members, and then to community councils, and then down to communities. And it's been mentioned that this bill will go some way to improve that. And the consultation aspect as well for policy and legislation. I just wonder if the panel could explain a little bit more about how that consultation would look in practice, because I think, you know, we all want to be able to consult with our constituents as much as we possibly can, and we know that the Scottish Government have in place statutory consultation periods for the legislation that they have to go through. I think probably, Alison, how do you see that working with COSLA? Would COSLA take a lead on that, or would the consultation be with local authorities themselves? Would it be elected members? Would it be chief executives? Would it be officers? How do you see that working?
Thank you, convener. This is about the relationship between Scottish Government and local government for the most part. This is about establishing that relationship and involving that engagement and supporting the engagement through parliamentary committees, through different bodies that we would liaise, we would discuss with before, as you say, the development of policy and make it most appropriate for our communities. That is what the Charter is about. The other issues, I suppose, are additional to the Charter and are not part of this bill at all. They're something that would happen in additional to that. So I don't think we need to get diverted by something that's maybe a side issue on this. But I think the really important thing is that by enhancing the role of local government, by giving a confidence in the importance of local government and as the voice of communities right across the length and breadth of Scotland, by doing that, we will be encouraging more people to come forward to stand and represent their local communities. And therefore, we'd have more of a voice from women, more of a voice from ethnic minorities, more of a voice from disabled people and all our other protected characteristics right across Scotland, because they would have that confidence to come forward in that participatory democracy locally to be that voice. So I think what the Charter isn't about how we would consult at a local level. The Charter is about that relationship between Scottish Government and local government. It's about giving that confidence to the role of local government, enhancing its role within Scotland, showing the value and esteem in which local government is held, and by doing so, by encouraging people to step forward and be part of it. And when we've got those voices at the table in local government, we have stronger democracy and we have consultation itself happening on a more ongoing basis without needing something to be set up by which to do it.
But sorry, Councillor, just to come back in on that point there, putting in legislation a European charter is not going to encourage more women into local politics. Improving the terms and conditions, putting up the wages, having consideration for childcare, and as you say, improving the confidence of women that want to come in to stand for elected positions is going to help women stand for election. So I don't see how we get that message across. Maybe you can help me out here, that a European charter is going to encourage gender balance in local authorities.
If I may, convener, there are lots of reasons why people don't get involved in politics. And just because one method of adjusting those doesn't cover everything doesn't mean we shouldn't do it. Because one thing doesn't do everything doesn't mean we shouldn't do anything. And I think it is an important stage in that one reason people don't get involved, as well as all the other reasons you pointed out, one reason people don't get involved is they feel their voice isn't heard. They feel they're not able to make a difference. They feel that local government isn't held in the esteem it should be, and that decisions are actually being made somewhere else. By putting this charter into place, and I suppose as Andrew Fraser has always said, you know, the onus needs to be on why not? And if we don't do it, what does that show about the esteem of local government? What does that show about the voice of local government? By enshrining this charter, we say that local government does have a voice. It's important to have consultation between local government and Scottish Government. We acknowledge that. We accept the journey that we're on moving forward in democracy in Scotland, and that this is part of that picture. So, yes, it doesn't solve every problem. I'll be the first to agree with that. But it does go some of the way, and we should take the steps that we can. And this is an easy hit to take that step. This is an easy way of showing the esteem in which local government is held. Thank you.
Okay, thanks. I suppose I'm just looking for positive and practical differences it's actually going to make, rather than just sending a signal that we hold local government in high esteem, which, you know, as been said before, we should be doing already. Absolutely. It shouldn't take a new piece of legislation to do that. I wonder if either of our other panellists have got an opinion on that.
Yeah. Thanks. Convener, can I come in?
Yes, yes. Thank you. Sorry, you're off my screen.
Yeah, no. I very much agree with what the president has said. Gail Ross is correct. We continually hear words about how much local government is held in esteem at Holyrood. Unfortunately, that doesn't play out in my experience in the day to day. It doesn't feel that way. In comparison to other European local government models, our one doesn't feel local, and it certainly doesn't feel like government. And I think Andrew Fraser's previously made the point as well. It's the signal if we don't adopt this, it's the signal that sends out. So I think that this won't fix all the issues. It won't fix all the issues that Gail Ross has raised about gender equality, for example. But it will go some way. We need to engender enthusiasm for local government. People need to see that by standing for election and becoming elected and getting involved, they can make a real difference. And when people come to me as we move towards elections in 18 months' time and say to me, you know, give me a reason for standing, sometimes it's difficult, because to be perfectly honest, I would struggle to say what areas that I have real influence over, and that makes it quite difficult. So I think it is about it's a step along the way. It's about turning around the decades of erosion of influence and power that local government has lost. Thanks.
Okay.
I'm still.
Sorry, Anne.
That Gail Ross makes is an important one, which is very much about, I suppose, ultimately, what difference does this make in terms of overall community empowerment? And I think that is a very, very serious issue for the overall local governance review. And this is just one of the tools in the box. I think, however, this bill does fit well within that overall framework of subsidiarity, that powers should go down to the lowest level. Inevitably, local government, whether you think of, you know, governments in terms of spheres or tiers, is closer to the community and the peoples, and better able, should be certainly better able, to achieve outcomes targeted towards individual communities. So I think from that point of view, to pass a bill that supports charter obligations, which empower local government, should in turn feed down to local government being able to support its communities and achieve solutions targeted towards the needs of those individual communities. But I agree totally, there is a much wider issue, very much tied up with the local governance review, as to how we can get to that point where community organisations, communities, community planning partners, councils and Scottish Government identify, you know, shared priorities, and everyone works towards achieving that. But I think that's a much wider issue. But this bill, it helps that, I would say.
Okay.
Thank you very much. Can I just say the three witnesses that the majority of this panel have been councillors, and I'm a bit surprised to hear a councillor say that he couldn't explain to people why they should be councillors, because I doubt there's an ex-councillor on this committee that couldn't say what they managed to do as a councillor or how being a councillor was beneficial both to their communities and themselves. So I accept that there are issues, and I accept that local authorities might have issues with the government or whatever, but I don't really think we should be painting this picture that everything is doom and gloom and being a councillor is a terrible job and I don't know why anybody would want to take it, which is kind of the message that's coming across, certainly to me anyway. Anyway, sorry, Keith, follow up, please.
Yeah, can I say just to try and follow that, that I agree both with yourself, convener, and with Councillor Bell for various reasons. But two questions, the first one of which is, one of the panellists said that we don't want to be bedfellows with Hungary. We are this is in terms of not putting the charter into law, I think. We're currently bedfellows with Wales and England. And Councillor Everson mentioned that because I had previously tried to convince the UK government to put this into law as well and had not succeeded, and I assume that's still going on in concert with the LGA. What reasons is she aware of, or what reasons were given by England and Wales for not doing as we are now being asked to do, to put it into law?
Thank you, convener. Those negotiations with the UK government were obviously in the days before the Scottish Parliament. The work of COSLA over the last decades has been with the Scottish Parliament, because this is a law that we can enact in Scotland, and that's where our focus is and what we need to do. Why it hasn't been enacted? I don't know. The onus needs to be on the government to decide why they haven't wanted to enact it, because it fits in with all the human rights portfolio of work that the Scottish government's doing currently on human rights. It's very much compatible with all that. It fits in with our international obligations, and is an international treaty that, you know, we have ratified so far. To enact is the next stage, and to have our place as we feel that we should have on an international stage, it's important to fulfil our international obligations. And also, you know, it's the right thing to do in terms of democracy and the journey we're on with democracy. I live here in a royal borough. Royal boroughs have been part of the system of local government in Scotland for centuries. Now, this is the next stage on a journey that's been going on right since that time onwards. And it's important that we seek that perspective and we see what do we need to do now to move on with our democracy, to take things forward to the next step, to empower our communities, to really deliver as we wish in a democratic country. Thank you.
Yeah, just to say, that wasn't really my question. My question, because obviously there's a commonality between England, Wales and Scotland under UK law. And, well, if it's the case that you can't say why England, Wales wouldn't do it, is there no coordination between COSLA and the LGA on this issues across the UK?
Thank you, convener. We are working very much in Scotland on this issue. We are working with you and our partners in the Scottish Parliament, Scottish Government, in order to get this ratified in Scotland. That is where we can make that difference. It has not been on the agenda currently with the LGA. We've been talking with other issues over the LGA. We've got COVID, we've got Brexit issues, EU transition issues to talk about there. Our current concern is in Scotland, because that is where we can make a difference. That is where this is on the statute bill. This is where Andrew Whiteman's introduced the bill. This is where we have a chance to put it on the statute book here in Scotland and to make that difference. We take the lead in this one. I don't think we want to go down the line of because somebody else in the UK hasn't done it. We shouldn't. I think it's really important that we do what's right here. We have a bill in front of us. We have a chance to enshrine this charter in law, and for all the right reasons in terms of local democracy and the journey that we're on in Scotland. Thank you.
Okay. Can I try with Councillor Bell, his point that he's made about centralisation over the decades? Just thinking about the pattern of that, it tends to, in my view, have followed times of economic crises. So in the 1980s, you know, prior to the 1980s, you had councils running energy companies, airports, all sorts of things. Then you had the economic downturn in the 80s. In the early 2000s, I remember as a council leader trying to convince the then Scottish Government that the level of funding given to local authorities
it was an indicator of parity of esteem, and it was following the proportion of funding from the Scottish Executive to local authorities. And you mentioned 2007, and of course after that we had 2008 and the crash. If it is the case, and I think it is, but I'm not trying to put words in your mouth, that centralisation will tend to be a factor of governments trying to respond to economic crises or pressures, how would the adoption of the Charter, do you think, help safeguard that, given the point that was made before that the places where they've already adopted the Charter can use phrases like or within national economic policy to not do certain things? If you follow the meaning there, how would the Charter help with that, if you like, centralisation accelerated by economic crises? That's our Councillor Bell.
Thank you again. I think that's a really interesting point about how you seem to have cut. You know, there are stages. I mean, it's eroded over a number of decades, but there are key stages, and I think that's probably a good point. We're seeing it happening again with COVID. I think the difficulty is that we're not resetting back once we've come out of those crises, and we shouldn't be using those crises as an excuse, as it were, to suck powers into the centre, and then keep them there. I mean, if I may touch on the points that the convener made as well, I mean, it's becoming more difficult for me as a councillor to explain to people, in simple terms, the differences you can make, because, you know, 60% of our revenue budget goes on delivering national outcomes, you know, and in that sense, we're becoming very much like health boards, I guess. So in Scotland, we have a very weak system of local government in comparison to most of the other countries in Europe. And I believe that what this bill would do would be would act as a check, would act as a reminder to ministers that local government is there, that it's important, that they are key partners. We want to be key partners. We want to work together to deliver good services, the excellent services for our communities and for people across Scotland. Thanks.
Okay, I don't want to take Auntie Keith's time, so I won't respond to you. Keith?
With apologies to Andrew Fraser, that's enough for me, convener. I'm happy to move on, given the time.
Okay, thank you very much. Alexander?
Thank you, convener. Can I talk about some of the financial issues? Can I ask members of the panel about the financial memorandums for the bill and how accurate projected costs might be? Do you have a view on that?
Andrew Fraser.
I suppose that depends very much on the extent to which the principles of the Charter are already embedded in the Scottish Government. In other words, is there a need for substantial training of officers of government? And secondly, if those principles aren't currently, you know, having regard to, then what's the likelihood of challenge? But, you know, I know a relatively modest sum has been put in place. I don't think that's particularly unreasonable. You know, you might have £100,000 per annum, perhaps, involved in certainly initially training. Thereafter, once the principles are embedded and everyone knows what they're doing, I would think the chance of challenge will be nil, and the costs will be relatively modest. I think compared to the benefits of, you know, better working relationships, I think they will far outweigh any costs, which in comparison to most bills, I would think are pretty modest.
Councillor Everson, do you want to come in?
Just to say, I would agree with that entirely. I think the costs will be very, very modest, if at all. The need for training and guidance. I think we're talking about people who are in this world already. We're talking about people who work in the Scottish Government, work in local government. Training and awareness, I would be surprised if it's needed in any great sense, that people are used to working in this world anyway. So I take that as negligible. And I don't believe actually it features in the financial memorandum. And I think that's important, because it's not necessary to do so. And I do think that last point that Andrew Fraser just made is a crucial one. Now, what are the outcomes we're going to get out of this? What are the benefits we're going to get out of this? What are the benefits from being able to have policies that are developed and more appropriate in from the beginning? We've had experience in recent years where policies have been developed without local government, and then it's been seen that it's not going to work, and therefore we need to go back and revisit it. And as soon as local government has been involved, things have gone forward in partnership and been highly successful. I'll point to the 1140 hours as an example of that, and how once local government was there around the table, the system worked and has brought huge benefits across Scotland from that. So I think we need to look at the benefits, the outcomes from enshrining this in law, to making sure that we have that better partnership working, so that we have better policy, and therefore we move on in a better way. And I think the financial gains far outweigh any cost that people might fear. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Councillor Bell, any comments?
No, thanks, Convener. I agree entirely with my colleagues on the panel, so in the interest of brevity, I'll not repeat. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Alexander?
I'm content with that, Convener. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. And Andy, do you have any questions for this panel?
Thank you, Convener. No, just thank the witnesses. I have no questions.
Okay, thank you very much. In that case, that completes our evidence session. Thank you very much to the panel for their attendance this morning and their very helpful contributions. Our next evidence session in the Bill is on the 2nd of December with the Scottish Government. Thanks for helping identify some key issues to follow up on at that meeting. Members of the panel can leave the meeting by pressing the red telephone icon, and I remind committee members that they remain in public for the next item. Thank you very much to the witnesses. Thank you. Okay. Agenda item 5. Excuse me a second. There's public petitions P1743 and PE1778. One is an ongoing petition, and the other one is the committee is considering for the first time. Petition 1743 from John Foster on behalf of Govan Community Council calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to amend the Rent Scotland Act 1984 to prevent disproportionate rent increases being set for Scottish secure tenants. We last considered this petition on the 21st of August 2020 and agreed to write to the Scottish Government, the Scottish Federation of Housing Associations, the Glasgow and West of Scotland Forum of Housing Associations, Living Rent and the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service to seek information or views on issues raised in the petition. The responses can be found at paragraph 9 of paper 4, along with an update from the petitioner himself. A late response from the SFHA has also been provided by the clerks. I invite comments from members to consider next steps in light of the responses received. Does anybody wish to come in? Andy?
Thank you very much indeed, Convener. As I think I indicated at our previous discussion on this petition, I think the petitioner has a valid point. I think the question of comparative rents and what constitutes comparative rents is a vitally important legal question, particularly so as since this particular legislation, the 84 Act was passed, we've seen a very huge growth in the private rented market. We've seen a huge change in property tenure since that time. We've seen thousands, tens of thousands of council houses, for example, become owner-occupied. And we've seen much greater diversity in housing tenure in any local communities. So the provisions that were established in 1984 were particular to the tenure and the rental markets that existed in 1994. And I think, you know, 1984 rather, is 40 years ago. So I disagree with the government's view that no change is merited here. I can understand the government's reluctance to introduce primary legislation which would seek to amend, update, reform the rental conditions covering a relatively small number of, if I can call them, legacy tenants, if you like, people who are on tenancies that by and large now have disappeared. But nevertheless, that's still a really important role for Parliament. If people are on tenancies, if the provisions governing their rental reviews are out of date, it is incumbent on Parliament to at least consider remedying that, even if it only does affect a relatively small number of people. It's not their fault that they are in a very small number. So my view would be the committee should indeed recommend to government and agree with the petitioner that the 1984 Act should be amended. Thank you, convener.
Okay, thank you, Andy. Sarah?
Yes, thank you, James. And if you can note my former employment with the SFHA, I basically agree with Andy. And when we look at the papers we have in front of us, there is an issue about, this is a loophole effectively for a small number of tenants. And I think it needs to be acted on because they shouldn't be compared with private sector rents in terms of future rent rises. So I know it's not a huge issue going forward for the whole of the social rented sector, but I think it's something that needs to be tidied up. And I would agree, it'd be good to recommend to the Scottish Government that they could have a proper look at this. Thank you, convener.
Okay, does anybody else have any other views? No, in that case, are we happy then to write to the Scottish Government saying that there is obviously a small group of people who are affected by an anomaly in the 1984 and ask them to look to see how we can remedy that? Would that meet with everybody's, including yours, Andy? Andy?
Well, self-evidently it meets with my approval. Yes, I'm recommending that course of action.
Yeah, okay, I'll just make sure that I was in the right direction for what you were asking. Right, okay, well, I'll ask the clerks to draft up a letter and get it sent round for our approval. Okay, thank you. Petition 1778 by David Findleton calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to review the effectiveness of the Scottish Landlords Register scheme. Mr Findleton's view is that councils don't appear to be policing the register and in particular are not applying the fit and proper person test in the rigorous way that would have been intended when the legislation was drawn up. Do any members have views on this with reference to the options set out in paragraph 18 of page 4? Sarah.
Thank you, convener. Yes, I think this is something that's worth further investigation. And there's a very useful set of suggestions from the clerks. I think it would be useful to refer the petition to Scottish ministers and get them to take a look at it. I think a little bit more thought would be worth going into it. I noticed that the UK Collaborative Centre for Housing and the UK CCHE have pulled together some research which says that there are some issues in here, and looking at some of the feedback from local authorities suggests that this is something that needs to be looked at. They say particularly that Scottish authorities reported a lack of clear guidelines to inform enforcement decisions, particularly in relation to the application of the fit and proper person test. So I'd be very keen to get the Scottish Government's views on it, as to whether that is something where guidance would be helpful. It's not saying that all landlords are not good at all, and we have got Scottish Association of Landlords do represent them, but it's identifying there might be there might be some gaps here in terms of how this issue is properly addressed, which could impact on tenants. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. I've certainly had a number of constituency cases where this has been an issue, and I'd be happy for us to write to the government or whatever other action we think is appropriate, but I certainly don't think that we should be letting this slide. Does anybody else have any other views or want to make a comment? And Alexander, then Andy, sorry.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, I concur with the comments of Sarah Boyack and yourself. This is certainly an area that needs to be looked at, because there are a number of constituents across the areas, and the constituents have an issue with it. And as I say, when we look at how the local authorities manage it, most of it is done through the licensing provision and the teams within that, and holding the register and checking that the regulations are being enforced and are being active. And I think that's important as well, that we look at how that is looked at. So I would very much agree that that something needs to go to the minister so that they can consider some of the options that are being expressed here.
Okay, thank you, Alexander. Andy?
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I mean, I think the petitioner raises valid concerns. And I think some of the concerns relate to how the law is applied by local authorities. And I think some of the concerns relate to the law itself and whether it could be clearer or stricter or more flexible, etc. And I was quite taken by the UK Collaborative Centre for Housing Evidence's report, which did identify or highlighted in paragraph 21 of the paper, highlight issues, for example, that the relevant legislation had been hastily assembled, and that the Scottish local authorities also reported lack of clear guidelines to inform enforcement decisions. So I think there's a bit of a disconnect between what the government think should be the case, what is actually the case on the ground, and also, and very importantly, what tenants feel should be the case, which will be a mixture of enforcement and implementation and the legislation itself. So my suggestion would be that we seek some evidence on this question from witnesses as to the particular concerns raised by the petitioner, but also in a broader question as to whether the landlord registration scheme is deemed to be fit for purpose. I don't think we're going to have time to take oral evidence, for example, given the fact that dissolution is a matter of months away. But I do think being informed by some written evidence would be useful. We could then incorporate, we would have to close the petition, obviously, at dissolution. What happens to petitions at dissolution? But we could close the petition by writing to the government after we've taken some written evidence. And then I think probably, and this would remain to be determined, of course, but probably, you know, making some reference to outstanding issues that might arise in our legacy report. Thanks, Convener.
Okay, thank you, Andy. Keith?
I wouldn't support taking evidence. I think we've got to try and have a look at the workload that we have. For nearly 3 years into this meeting, we've still got a fair bit to go, and most meetings coming up, I think, are probably quite similar. But I do think the point about, you know, who's responsible where, I think the inclination can sometimes be always to go back to the government. And if it's the case that the regulations are unclear, then that's the right place to go, and I have no problem with that. But if it's also the case, because local authorities are not enforcing it in the way that people want, that is a question for local authorities. And if we don't acknowledge that, we're just in the position of being the Scottish government must legislate, take action, issue guidance to force local authorities once again to do this, that and the other. So I think we should be balanced in this, and maybe it's a question of taking up with COSLA some of the issues which are rightly for local authorities. But I've no problem with taking further action. I just don't think we've got time for further evidence, to be honest, but that's just my view, Convener.
Just to note that both COSLA and the Scottish Association of Landlords failed to reply to the Petitions Committee when they were asked to give evidence, which it doesn't bode well. I tend to agree with Keith that we should probably write to the minister. I, I'm not sure about who else we'd write to, but I certainly don't think we should be letting this lie because there is an issue here. I do think, certainly I can only speak for my own area, I do think that there's local authorities that use the government to get out of doing what they should be doing because they find it quite difficult. We've had a number of cases round about this. Is there anybody else has got any comment on this in terms of what action we should take? Okay, well, the suggestion is that we can refer this to Scottish, the petition to Scottish ministers or another committee or person or body for them to take such action as they consider appropriate, report it to the Parliamentary Bureau or to the Parliament, take any other action which the committee considers appropriate, which was basically what Andy was saying, and we won't be closing the petition down. I think that's pretty clear. I think that we should write to the minister outlining our concerns and then see what sort of response we get for there, because there is no time to take evidence. And I think that even if we did get written evidence, it's another thing that we'd have to try and fit into our busy schedule if how to deal with it. So my thoughts are we should write to the minister outlining the petition's concerns and also the concerns that we have as well. Are we happy to go along with that? Andy?
Yes, thanks, Convener. I suppose the only thing I would add to your suggestion is that the Petitions Committee has already written to the Minister and the Minister has replied. I'm not sure what the Minister would say differently to this committee. That would be my only concern about that. I understand Keith Brown's concern. I understand the concerns of members and indeed yourself about pressures on time. I was just suggesting some written evidence. I know that would obviously involve us then considering that. But if the committee feel we don't have time, then that's perfectly fair.
I think maybe the one thing we could do that the Petitions Committee didn't do is say that we recognise that this should be looked at. Maybe I don't know, because I don't know what letter the Petitions Committee sent, but this, we recognise this is an issue, local authorities maybe get a case to answer, or the Scottish Government should tighten up regulations. But if we wrote a firmer letter than the Petitions Committee, then we might get a response that we're looking for. Okay. Right. So we could also, although COSLA didn't respond to the Petitions Committee, they may well respond to us. Sarah, you wanted to come in. But just before you do, just to say that I was going to suggest we write to both the Scottish Government and COSLA on this. Sarah.
Thanks, James. I was just going to agree with you on that. I think that is that we don't have a lot of time. We need to say there is clearly evidence that needs to be looked at and action is required. So it's not a fobbing the petition off to the Scottish Government. It's saying that we want a proper response from them. So I think that pulls together both your and Andy's thoughts, and particularly if we make COSLA and the Scottish Association of Landlords aware that we're doing this, I think that would be helpful. Thank you.
Yes. Well, let's hope that they both respond to this committee when they didn't bother responding to the Petitions Committee. Okay, thanks very much for that then. So we're clear on what we're going to be doing. And that should conclude the public part of this meeting. And we'll resume the meeting in private in Microsoft Teams. We are pressed for time this morning, so I propose we resume the meeting in private in 5 minutes. Please accept the clerk's meeting request for the private discussion, which will be sent shortly. Thanks very much. You know how to exit the meeting.